Okay, so our first guest is Eileen Anderson, and Eileen writes the award-winning Eileen and Dogs blog, where she shares information on training and living with her three dogs, Summer, Zani, and Clara. She's published articles in Barks from the Guild magazine and has also presented webinars for PPG. So hello, Eileen, and welcome to the show.
Hi, Louise. Thanks for having me, and good morning, afternoon, and evening to everybody out there.
You got that right, actually. It's evening for me, and I think Nikki said afternoon, and I'm sure it's morning for other people, so that's perfect. As I just mentioned, you've presented webinars for the PPG. Why is being a member of the Pet Professional Guild actually important to you, Eileen?
Well, there are so many things I could say. The materials such as the webinars, the handouts, the position statements are invaluable for anyone who's a professional trainer or a hobby trainer like myself. But really, the make or break thing is the guiding principles and the ethical stance that PPG takes. You know, you all are brave enough to say this is what we do and this is what we don't do. We disallow tools that hurt animals. And most very important is that we put the animal first in consideration whenever we're training.
Thank you, Eileen. That was really nicely said. Thank you. Well, we're actually here today to talk about your new book, which is titled Remember Me, Loving and Caring for a Dog with Canine Cognitive Dysfunction. And it tells the story of your small terrier, Cricket, who developed canine cognitive dysfunction. If you've got a senior dog, Remember Me can help in crucial ways. You discuss the symptoms of canine cognitive dysfunction, the medications and other interventions that are showing promise in treating the condition, how to adapt your home, habits to keep your dog safe, the many products available to solve the problems of senior dogs. I could go on, but obviously we're going to chat about the book and people need to read it to find out everything. But can you tell us a little bit about Cricket's first symptoms and how long it took for her to get diagnosed?
Well, I'll be glad to. And the first symptoms I completely missed. I misunderstood. If I knew anything about dementia in dogs at that time, I would have been looking for, you know, obvious signs of confusion or getting mixed up. But Cricket's first symptom was a heightening of anxiety and that she stopped being comfortable with someone she had loved and known all of her life, my workmate at my office. And I took Cricket there, and all of a sudden, Cricket was backing away from her and acting nervous. And I just thought, well, you know, she's getting more anxious with age. She's always been a little anxious. And I went to the vet, and that was all I needed to say. So we treated it as an anxiety problem. And the drugs at that time didn't agree with her. And so I thought, well, you know, I'll just do the best I can to help her feel safe and secure, but this is something we're going to have to live with. That lasted for about 9 months until her further symptoms became more obvious. Want me to go ahead and talk about what happened then?
So what were the further symptoms then?
Then they became more obvious. One of the things that happens with dogs with canine cognitive dysfunction is that they get stuck places. Their brains are deteriorating, and they don't make the decisions that we often would make. If I were stuck in a corner, you know, my eyes would tell my brain, you know, this is not a great place to be. Let's turn around. A dog with canine dysfunction loses that ability to make those connections and loses the volition to do something about it. And so she started standing in corners, standing around, just kind of gazing into space, pacing, walking in circles. And another symptom that is quite unusual, but once you've seen it, you can recognize it, is that dogs with dementia tend to forget what side of the door is the side that opens. Even if they've been going out a certain door all their life, they'll stand at the hinge side and just stand there and wait and not understand. And then when you try to open the door, of course, they don't know to back up. So trouble with doors was a very obvious one for Cricket.
Wow, that's something that you wouldn't actually think about as well, you know, them going to the wrong side of the door. Yeah, very interesting.
No.
Okay, so lots of people actually don't realize that their dog is suffering from a condition beyond normal aging until the disease
That's
is quite advanced, yeah? Can you explain exactly what is canine cognitive dysfunction?
Sure. It's a term for mental and behavioral decline that's associated with actual changes in the brain. And the changes in the brain are very similar to what happens with humans with Alzheimer's. Not all of the same brain changes are present, but the dogs get the beta amyloid plaques like people do. And there have been studies that show they correlate the deteriorating behavior with these plaques in the dog's brain. So the important thing to know, it's a neurological condition, it's got behavioral symptoms, and it is definitely different from normal aging.
Okay, so you just said it's got definite symptoms. So what are some of, you've mentioned a couple of symptoms that Cricket had, but what are the symptoms, or some of them, of canine cognitive dysfunction?
I want to mention that any individual symptom that I mentioned today can also be a symptom for other serious conditions. So you can't take the list and diagnose your dog over the internet. The diagnosis of this disease is one of exclusion. A vet has to rule out a number of other serious conditions. But anyway, the old list of symptoms that a lot of vets went by goes by the acronym DISHA. That's D-I-S-H-A. And that stands for disorientation, interactions, meaning interactions have changed with people and other animals in the household, sleep problems, H is for house soiling, housebreaking problems, and A is for activity level alterations, meaning the dog loses energy or gains energy in odd ways, and often that combines with the sleep problems and you get a dog that is naturally trying to sleep through the day and wander through the night. DISHA doesn't quite cover everything. It doesn't actually cover the fact that the dog can't learn anything anymore as the disease progresses. The memory problems and the learning are also very important. But those are the biggies.
Okay, and which of those problems did Cricket have? We've already said that disorientation obviously was one, and interactions, you mentioned interaction with your work colleague.
Right. Interaction was the first one, and that was the one I missed for so long. Definitely disorientation. We were lucky that she didn't have a big problem with sleep, and I just count my blessings on that because that's one of the things that's so very, very hard about this disease. She did have breakdown of her house training. She lost her house training for defecation, but not for urination, which meant that I had to take certain, you know, measures in the house, and I didn't notice so much about the activity. So the big ones for her were disorientation, these changed relationships, the house soiling, and just her inability to learn anything new.
Right, and how long was it? I asked you actually at the beginning, but how long was it until you actually got her diagnosed that you realized what the problem was? It was about 9 months. And was there any treatment available, and is there treatment available now?
Yes, and it's kind of similar to the Alzheimer's situation. There is no cure. There's some Australian research that actually is promising right now, but I can still safely say there's no cure. And the things that do help that have been shown in clinical trials and peer-reviewed research to help, they help slow the process. They don't generally turn it around, and they don't cure it. But there are, depending on what part of the world you're in, there are different drugs that have been shown to help. The one in the U.S. is selegiline, which is, the brand name is Anapril, and it's been shown in studies to slow some of the deterioration. Adrafinil is one of the ones in Europe that's used. A lot of these drugs have to do with encouraging activity in the brain and elsewhere, and so this kind of a tricky thing not to get a hyperactive dog. But there are the drugs. There are two diets in the U.S. that have been clinically shown to help. There are some supplements that have been shown weekly, you know, like with one study or one very, you know, a small study or a couple that you know, haven't quite been replicated yet. There are some supplements that have been shown to help. The important thing is, oh, and of course, enrichment. Enrichment has shown to slow the decline, the mental decline. The important thing is that all of these things help more if the intervention is sooner. And that's one of the big reasons I wrote my book, because I didn't want anybody else to have a 9-month delay in diagnosing what was wrong with their dog.
Right, yes, yeah, I can understand that. You mentioned actually when you were talking about cricket that one of the things that did occur was the house training broke down. So what are some of the ways in which you had to change your household around in order to help cricket?
I made her a safe room. Besides having to account for a dog that was going to defecate and just go on and not do anything about it, I had to make a room safe where she wouldn't get stuck behind things. I had had that happen. She had gotten stuck in a framework under a table attached to the legs. She had been gotten stuck next to the toilet, you know, got wedged in there and didn't know to back out. So I made her a safe room that had nothing that she could, you know, that she couldn't get out of or that she could get trapped in. It had all washable flooring. I used foam-backed bath mats that I could pick up and get the poop off there and then wash the bath mats. And I had a webcam so that I could check in on her remotely. One of the things that happened to us, it's unpleasant, but these things happen when you're a dog owner. She would defecate, and then because she paced around, she would walk around in it. So I had a system for cleaning her feet as well. Of course, that was with me. She couldn't do that on her own. But I basically made a little room where everything she needed was there. We had a couple beds, and I put her food and water in a corner because she had this tendency just to keep walking forward. And if the food were in a bowl, like in the hallway, she would take a bite and then just walk on through it. So I put the important things in corners, and I put one bed out in the middle where she would literally stumble into it sometimes and go to sleep. And that was my basic setup. I had a place where only she was. I kept my other dogs out of there, and I made it as safe as possible for her and as easy to clean for me, and a place where I could also supervise with the webcam.
Right, and you just mentioned your other dogs, actually. How did the interaction change, did it, between Cricket and the other dogs?
It sure did. I had my three present dogs. I had all of them at that time. And Clara, my young dog, is 45 pounds, and I just kept them completely separated from the get-go. She was enthusiastic and ebullient and pushy, if I may say, and they didn't need to be interacting at all. There would not be anything to gain for Cricket. My medium-sized dog, Summer, had been aggressive to Cricket in the past, so she too was separated from Cricket permanently. I have a little friendly hound dog, that's Zany, and I did allow her to be in with Cricket at times, but only when I was there, because even as nice a dog as Zany, when a dog with dementia just kind of walks over you because they don't realize you're in a bed, you know, even a nice dog like that might snap or, you know, have some other way of saying she didn't care for that. And Cricket was not all that sociable with other dogs anyway. So I basically kept two of them completely away from her and the third one only together, you know, when I was there to supervise.
Okay, so obviously it was an awful lot of work for you, wasn't it?
Yes, it was. It was indeed. I tried to be organized about it, and I had a pretty smooth system. But yeah, there was quite a bit of cleanup and a lot of managing, a lot of taking one dog out the front and then taking another dog out the back and being sure that one dog is crated when I go through and that kind of thing.
Right. But I presume that in general, because you put in all this effort, that it actually made life much, much simpler in one respect for all of you, yes? You were able to
Yes.
manage the situation much better.
Yes. Once I got it set up and I figured out what it was that she needed, and of course that changed over time, but once I figured out how to do it, yeah, we had a pretty good, smooth little system, you know, including, you know, ways to wash her feet. I kept gloves handy and a little basin where I could just lift her. You know, that's the joy of a small dog. You can lift them up and dunk their feet in a basin. But I kept everything I needed to keep her clean and healthy and hygienic right there and the limited space helped too. It wasn't tiny. She had a hall to walk up and down and a large front room where she could pace, which I came to accept that was, you know, some good exercise for her. So I didn't mind when I saw her pacing and moving around.
Okay, you just actually mentioned that Cricket was a small dog. Does canine cognitive dysfunction mostly affect small breeds?
No, it doesn't. There has been a study that showed, it was a large study, some 900 dogs made it into the study, and these were not dogs that were known to have canine cognitive dysfunction. They just had to be older than a certain age limit. And they broke the dogs into three groups, I think, depending on their normal lifespans. And they found the incidence of canine cognitive dysfunction was the same over all sizes and all breeds of dogs. I think if you have a larger dog, there are more other things going on as they age, and it might be masked. You know, certainly the people who come to my website, you know, there seem to be an abundance of rat terriers and JRTs, things like that. But it does definitely affect all breeds and all sizes of dogs.
Okay, right. To be honest, I wondered, because obviously the smaller breeds tend to live for a longer time, don't they, than the larger breeds?
Right, exactly. And you would expect they would get it more, but
yeah,
when they adjust for age, that's not the case. All
okay.
of them get it. Yeah.
Yeah. And you just mentioned that you've got a website set up. I think you've had that set up for a couple of years now. What are most people actually looking for who come to your website?
Well, it's very sad. My website is dogdementia.com, and when people find it, their dogs are usually in the late stages of dementia. Like me, they didn't know about it, and unlike me, they took longer to find out, you know, and their dog is in a very advanced stage, and I would say more than half of them are already wrestling with whether to euthanize their dog, and it just kind of breaks my heart, because there were things they could have done earlier if they had known. But yet the question of euthanizing a dog for what we would call mental problems is a very thorny one, and it's very hard on people. And that's another thing that motivates me to get the word out about this, because people need to know that it really is a disease, and they need to know early about the signs and be able to do some interventions.
Right, that was actually going to be my next question, because in your book, Remember Me, Loving and Caring for a Dog with Canine Cognitive Dysfunction, you actually tackle the tough subject of euthanasia. Is it harder to consider, do you think, when a dog has dementia?
Absolutely. We're not used to the idea of a dog that can still walk and eat and express herself, that euthanasia might be appropriate. Generally, a vet told me this, but, you know, generally people start considering euthanasia when the dog won't eat anymore. And that can be pretty late in the game with a dog that has, you know, a painful condition. But also, we just don't tend to take mental diseases as seriously. And people have terrible guilt with the idea of euthanizing a dog that can still walk and eat and drink. But yet, I do think in some cases that is definitely the most humane thing to do. And of course, you know, I can't encourage people to do it, but I encourage people to look at the whole situation and measure the dog's quality of life in every possible way they can.
And are there any resources that can help people that find themselves
yeah.
in this situation? Yeah.
Yeah, there's a good scale. It's called the Villalobos Quality of Life Scale. And it was invented by a vet who actually deals a lot in hospice. And it has a rating scale where you rate all sorts of different conditions and activities for your dog and where they are. And even for people who dislike, you know, having to choose a number from 1 to 5 or 1 to 10, you know, there's kind of an icky factor of assessing your dog's quality of life with numbers. Even if you don't like the numbers part, a list like that will allow you to consider things you might not have thought of. You know, what are the pleasures in your dog's life now, and are they diminishing? Does your dog take pleasure in anything at all? Does your dog still know you? That was a big one for me. If and when Cricket had stopped knowing me, that would have been a consideration, because I was her anchor in life. and I was very lucky that she always continued to know me. But there are so many considerations, so having a list to go by is a huge help, I think. There's also a good book out there called Facing Farewell, and I don't have the vet's name right now. I think her name is Rec, R-E-C-K. It's not about dementia, it's just generally assessing a dog for euthanasia and what you would need to consider, and it also describes the process and all the corollaries that go with it. It's a very nice book.
Okay, thank you for that. In your opinion, what's the most important thing for dog owners to keep in mind if their dog actually has canine cognitive dysfunction?
It's that the dog's life, and this is opposite of what I just said, the dog's life is not necessarily over. Once we find out that, yes, this is a disease and it's progressive and it is a tragic disease. I don't talk about that a lot because it's obvious and people don't need to hear it as much as they need to hear there are things you can do about it. And that's my message. There are ways that you can help your dog to still have a sweet life with dementia. My little dog lived for probably 2, perhaps 3 years with dementia, and she had a good life to the very end. And it had to do with assessing what she needed, what she enjoyed, and how I could help her. But I was able to give her a sweet life, and I hope other people can not just be destroyed by the diagnosis and assume that, you know, the dog's life is over, because it's not. There are things that you can do.
Thank you, Eileen. I'm going to end actually with a little fun fact, because I was looking at your biography actually on Amazon, and I discovered this little fact, and it said that you've not only got perfect pitch, but that you can say the alphabet backwards in under 5 seconds. Is there any chance of a demonstration?
Oh, I never should have put that in, but yes, there is. What was that from the gallery back there? I didn't quite get it.
She said talk about
being put on the spot. That's a
horrible thing to do. But you learn, don't you? If you put it out there, you better be able to do it. Okay,
yeah.
So here we go. ZYXWVUTSRQPONMLKJIHGFEDCBA.
That gets you a round of applause, Eileen.
I'm glad we have that on a recording, because I'm going to go back afterwards and break it down and make sure we don't have a letter missed out.
Well, always check for the letter J. That's the one I like to leave out, but I think I got it today.
That is incredible. I couldn't even say it the right way round in under 5 seconds. That's brilliant.
Yeah, well, I can't either. I can't say it front ways that fast either.
Awesome.
So I have a follow-on. I have a follow-on question for that.
Okay.
How on earth do you even know you can do that, and why on earth were you even trying to do that?
I was hoping somebody would ask. When I was a kid, I sang in the church choir. I come from a musical family. And one of the songs the kids' choir sang was called the Mozart Alphabet Song. And in the song, you sing the alphabet frontwards and backwards, and then you sing it in German frontwards and backwards. And so if I were really going to be impressive, I would do it in German, but I can't do that anymore. But that little song is what taught me how to do it backwards, and I just, going through life, I decided that would be a nice skill to keep honed.
That's great. I love learning little things about people like that. It makes you look at them in a different light. So I'm looking at a photograph of you on the screen standing by a tree in a nice kind of fuchsia top with your book above you, and now all I can see is the alphabet whizzing around your head.
There you go.
Awesome. How can people get in touch with you, Eileen, and learn more, and where can they buy the book?
The book is on Amazon. It's only an ebook at this moment, but I am working very hard on the print version, and it should be out by the end of this month or perhaps in early March. But you can find the ebook on Amazon just by searching under books for dog dementia or canine cognitive dysfunction. You can go to my website, which is dogdementia.com. That's easy to find. And I'm easy to track down on social media because I'm Eileen and Dogs on Twitter, on Pinterest, on Facebook, and I'm pretty responsive. If people want to find me and ask me questions, I'm out there.
Thank you so much, Eileen. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. This was a blast.
You're so welcome. We look forward to having you back to talk more about your blog.
That'd be great.